verses 19 to 20. The merit he had for them is another thing here pleaded, v. 19 for their sakes I sanctify myself. Here Christ's designation of himself to the work and office of mediator, I sanctified myself. He entirely devoted himself to the undertaking, and all the parts of it, especially that which he was now going about the offering up of himself without spot unto God, by the eternal Spirit. He, as the priest and altar, sanctified himself as the sacrifice. When he said, Father, glorify thy name Father, thy will be done Father, I commit my spirit into thy hands, he paid down the satisfaction he had engaged to make, and so sanctified himself. This he pleads with his Father, for his intercession is made in the virtue of his satisfaction, by his own blood he entered into the holy place, Hebrews 9:12, as the high priest, on the day of atonement, sprinkled the blood of the sacrifice at the same time that he burnt incense within the veil, Leviticus 16:12, 14. Christ's design of kindness to his disciples herein, it is for their sakes, that they may be sanctified, that is, that they may be martyrs, so some. I sacrifice myself, that they may be sacrificed to the glory of God and the church's good. Paul speaks of his being offered, Philosophy 2:17, 2 Tim 4:6. Whatever there is in the death of the saints that is precious in the sight of the Lord, it is owing to the death of the Lord Jesus. But I rather take it more generally, that they may be saints and ministers, duly qualified and accepted of God. The office of the ministry is the purchase of Christ's blood, and one of the blessed fruits of his satisfaction, and owes its virtue and value to Christ's merit. The priests under the law were consecrated with the blood of bulls and goats, but gospel ministers with the blood of Jesus. The real holiness of all good Christians is the fruit of Christ's death, by which the gift of the Holy Ghost was purchased. He gave himself for his church, to sanctify it, F 5:25, 26. And he that designed the end designed also the means, that they might be sanctified by the truth which Christ came into the world to bear witness to and died to confirm. The word of truth receives its sanctifying virtue and power from the death of Christ. Some read it, that they may be sanctified in truth, that is, truly, for as God must be served, so, in order to this, we must be sanctified, in the Spirit, and in truth. And this Christ has prayed for all that are his, for this is his will, even their sanctification, which encourages them to pray for. Who are included in this prayer? V. 20 not these only that are now my disciples, the 11, the 70, with others, men and women that followed him when he was here on earth, but for those also who shall believe on me through their word, either preached by them in their own day or written by them for the generations to come, I pray for them all, that they all may be one in their interest in this prayer, and may all receive benefit by it. Those, and those only, are interested in the mediation of Christ, that do, or shall, believe in him. This is that by which they are described, and it comprehends all the character and duty of a Christian. They that lived then, saw and believed, but they in after ages have not seen, and yet have believed. It is through the word that souls are brought to believe on Christ, and it is for this end that Christ appointed the scriptures to be written, and a standing ministry to continue in the church, while the church stands, that is, while the world stands, for the raising up of a seed. It is certainly and infallibly known to Christ who shall believe on him. He does not here pray at a venture, upon a contingency depending on the treacherous will of man, which pretends to be free, but by reason of sin is in bondage with its children. No, Christ knew very well whom he prayed for. The matter was reduced to a certainty by the divine prescience and purpose. He knew who were given him, who being ordained to eternal life, were entered in the Lamb's book, and should undoubtedly believe, Acts 13:48. 4. Jesus Christ intercedes not only for great and eminent believers, but for the meanest and weakest, not for those only that are to be employed in the highest post of trust and honor in his kingdom, but for all, even those that in the eye of the world are inconsiderable. As the divine providence extends itself to the meanest creature, so does the divine grace to the meanest Christian. The good shepherd has an eye even to the poor of the flock. 5. Jesus Christ in his mediation had an actual regard to those of the chosen remnant that were yet unborn, the people that should be created, PS 22:31, the other sheep which he must yet bring. Before they are formed in the womb he knows them, John 1:5, and prayers are filed in heaven for them beforehand, by him who declareth the end from the beginning, and calleth things that are not as though they were. What is intended in this prayer, v. 21, that they all may be one? The same was said before, v. 11, that they may be one as we are, and again, v. 22. The heart of Christ was much upon this. Some think that the oneness prayed for in v. 11 has special reference to the disciples as ministers and apostles, that they might be one in their testimony to Christ, and that the harmony of the evangelists, and concurrence of the first preachers of the gospel, are owing to this prayer. Let them be not only of one heart, but of one mouth, speaking the same thing. The unity of the gospel ministers is both the beauty and strength of the gospel interest. But it is certain that the oneness prayed for in v. 21 respects all believers. It is the prayer of Christ for all that are his, and we may be sure it is an answered prayer that they all may be one, one in us, v. 21, one as ye are one, v. 22, made perfect in one, v. 23. It includes three things. That they might all be incorporated in one body. Father, look upon them all as one, and ratify that great charter by which they are embodied as one church. Though they live in distant places, from one end of heaven to the other, and in several ages, from the beginning to the close of time, and so cannot have any personal acquaintance or correspondence with each other, yet let them be united in me, their common head. As Christ died, so he prayed, to gather them all in one, ch. 1152, f. 110. That they might all be animated by one spirit. This is plainly implied in this, that they may be one in us. Union with the Father and Son is obtained and kept up only by the Holy Ghost. He that is joined to the Lord in one spirit, 1 Cor 6:17. Let them all be stamped with the same image and superscription, and influenced by the same power. That they might all be knit together in the bond of love and charity, all of one heart. That they all may be one. In judgment and sentiment, not in every little thing this is neither possible nor needful, but in the great things of God, and in them, by the virtue of this prayer, they are all agreed that God's favor is better than life, that sin is the worst of evils, Christ the best of friends, that there is another life after this, and the like. In disposition and inclination, all that are sanctified have the same divine nature and image, they have all a new heart, and it is one heart. They are all one in their designs and aims. Every true Christian, as far as he is so, eyes the glory of God as his highest end, and the glory of heaven as his chief good. They are all one in their desires and prayers, though they differ in words and the manner of expressions, yet, having received the same spirit of adoption, and observing the same rule, they pray for the same things in effect. 5. All one in love and affection. Every true Christian has that in him which inclines him to love all true Christians as such. That which Christ here prays for is that communion of saints which we profess to believe, the fellowship which all believers have with God, and their intimate union with all the saints in heaven and earth, 1 John 1:3. But this prayer of Christ will not have its complete answer till all the saints come to heaven, for then, and not till then, they shall be perfect in one, v. 23. F. 4:13. What is intimated by way of plea or argument to enforce this petition? Three things.